caught Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking together about all that had happened. Now, as they talked this over, Jesus himself came up and walked by their side. But something prevented them from recognizing him. He said to them, "What matters are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped short, their faces downcast. Then one of them called Cleopas answered him, "You must be the only person staying in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have been happening there these last few days." "What things?" he asked. "All about Jesus of Nazareth," he answered, "who proved he was a great prophet by the things he said and did in the sight of God and of the whole people, and how our chief priests and our leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death and had him crucified. Our own hope had been that he would be the one to set Israel free. And this is not all. 2 whole days have gone by since it all happened, and some women from our group have astounded us. They went to the tomb in the early morning, and when they did not find the body, they came back to tell us they had seen a vision of angels who declared he was alive. Some of our friends went to the tomb and found everything exactly as the women had reported, but of him they saw nothing." Then he said to them, "You foolish men, so slow to believe the full message of the prophets. Was it not ordained that the Christ should suffer and so enter into his glory? Then, starting with Moses and going through all the prophets, he explained to them the passages throughout the scriptures that were about himself. When the two near to the village to which they were going, he made a sign to go on, but they pressed him to stay with them. 'It is nearly evening,' he said, 'and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. Now while he was with them at table, he took the bread and said the blessing. Then he broke it and handed it to them. And their eyes were opened and they recognized him. But he had vanished from their sight. Then he said to each other, 'Did not our hearts burn within us as he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us?' They set out that instant and returned to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 assembled together with their companions, who said to them, 'Yes, it is true. The Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then they told their story of what had happened on the road and how they had recognized him at the breaking of bread." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
those to be ordained priests come forward. Reverend Jude Bimini.
Present.
About a Jew, a learned According to you, I am very interested in what you are teaching. I have heard of your faith and your great scholarly exploits. Now, can you summarize all these teachings of the Jewish belief in as brief as a time when somebody will be standing on one leg, which means within 1 minute? Can you summarize all the teachings so as to let me know if I can follow you or not, if I can be a disciple or not, if I can continue to believe the Jewish faith or not? The first rabbi looked at him, thought of the Ten Commandments, thought of the 613 precepts of the Jewish belief, thought of the Pentateuch, the 5 books of Moses, and all the teachings of the Jewish religion. How could he summarize all of them within a period when somebody is standing on one leg, in fact, one finger, one toe? And if you are standing on one toe, within 1 minute you will fall. Which means he was being told to summarize the entire Jewish faith in 1 minute. He looked at the young man and told him, "It is not possible." So the young man said, "Then I cannot follow you." He left. But he didn't want to give up. He went to the next great rabbi, very famous rabbi, and posed the same question. "I've heard of your name, your faith, and your great teachings. Can you summarize for me the Jewish religion within the period when somebody could be standing on one leg? In fact, on the toes of his feet?" He looked at him and said, "Whatever is offensive to you, don't do it to another." This is the summary of all the teachings, the commandments, and the prophets. Every other thing is commentary. The young man went away very happy and said, "Whatever is offensive to me, I should not do to another. That is enough. I will follow you." Now it comes to my mind, if somebody tells you to summarize the priesthood of Christ in 1 minute, when somebody is standing on one leg, before he starts feeling pains on the leg, you should be able to tell him everything about the priesthood. But say, "Constance," or, "Okay, I need them for today. They are not yet priests. Can I look at our MC or the vicar general?" No, today they are vested in the regalia. Don't ask them questions when they are there. If I ask you now, will you be able to tell me that? Okay, I will not ask you. Let me spend a couple of minutes. Let me ask myself then. Can we summarize the priesthood of Christ in 1 minute? And that leads us to the second part of our family, discussing the priesthood of Christ. If you are going to summarize the priesthood of Christ in 1 minute, just tell that person it is a gift and a sacrifice of love. It is a gift and a sacrifice of love. How? But you have already given the person a suffering. If you want to know how the priesthood is a gift, you go back to the Old Testament, and from the Old Testament, you come to the New Testament. From the time of Moses, go, I will send you to Pharaoh. What was the qualification of Moses? And Moses said, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? And God insisted that he had to go. I will tell you what he said. I will send you and go and tell him, let my people go. Let my people go. And God accompanied Moses until the job was accomplished. Did Moses apply for the post? Did he apply for the post? He was just called. When he was called, he was given the gift of being chosen and given the mandate, the strength of God, the power of God to walk in the name of God. And God accompanied Moses. And Moses became a great leader who received the commandment from God, who saw the Almighty face to face. And that was Moses. If you go to Jeremiah, when he was called, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I consecrated you. It follows that it is a gift. Before he was born, before he was ever born, God knew him. Before he was born, he consecrated him. I make you a prophet to the nations. Jeremiah said, I'm a child. Don't worry. Don't say you are a child. So it remains a gift. From the readings of today, from the epistle to the Hebrews, we read, no one takes this honor to himself, except one, he who is called as Aaron was. So if you are not called, you cannot take it. It is a gift, a privileged gift. You go to the words of Christ, he told the apostles, you did not choose me. No, I chose you. I chose you and commissioned you to go and bear fruits, fruits that will last. Again, in the Gospel of Luke chapter 22, before he left this earth, he called those he has chosen and went to suffer with them. And after the supper, he took the bread, said the blessing, and then commissioned them, after telling them, this is my body, which will be given up, which will be offered for you. And this is my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Now he mandated them, do this in memory of me. He mandated them and he sent them out. What was the qualification of the apostles? Their qualification was known to God alone. You think of somebody like Samuel. He was still the servant boy when he was called. Samuel, Samuel, and he ran to his master. Here I am, my God, can you say that I didn't call you and save my son? The third time, he had Samuel, Samuel, he ran to his master. The master said, now, go back. If you hear that voice again, hear the voice, speak. Your servant is blessed. And the Lord started communicating with and to Samuel. And Samuel became a great prophet. He was yet the servant of God. It is an unmerited gift. It is a gratuitous gift. It is an unmerited privilege. It is God's own grace. So the priesthood is a gift. Nobody qualifies for it. It is entirely God's own initiative. Remember when David was chosen, he was the youngest among the brothers. And when the prophet went to the family, all his brothers passed on. And the Spirit of the Lord told his prophet, no, the Lord has not chosen this. And when all of them passed, he asked their father, are your sons finished? He in fact said, yes, they are finished, but only one small one in the field, then the sheep said, go and cover him. I will not sit down. I will not drink water. I will not eat in the house until I see the boy. And when the boy was coming, behold, he was a pleasant boy, with sparkling eyes, with many natural endowments, but he was not bigger than his brothers. He was not more handsome than his brothers. But the Spirit of the Lord told the prophet, yes, that's the one the Lord has chosen. And when he knelt down, he anointed him, and the Spirit of the Lord rushed down on David. So the Lord chooses whom he pleases. And the Spirit comes down when you are consecrated, and you are transformed. Now you are able to act in the person of Christ and in the power of the Lord. Is the priesthood a gift or not? Is it a gift? Yes. And I say it is a gift and sacrifice of love. Now, as you listen now, you will hear what you have heard here several times during the ordinations. During the interrogations, five questions are asked to the elect, to the candidates. And the last question is what I will read out now. Are you resolved to be united more closely every day, not one day, not one week, not one month, not one year, not 10 years, not 50 years, but every day, are you resolved to be united more closely every day to Christ, the High Priest, who offered himself for us to the Father as a pure sacrifice, and with him consecrate yourself to God for the salvation of all, and you say, I do by the grace of God. Once the answer is to continue. If the Lord answer it, that will not be nations. So when they tell us that they are resolved to unite more closely every day to Christ, who offered himself as a sacrifice to the Father, and then offered themselves also, consecrate themselves to God for the salvation of all. So if they are ready to unite themselves to Christ and offer themselves as a sacrifice to God, then the nations will be blessed. And this sacrifice is ongoing as long as you live. Constance, are you with me? Jude, Kenneth, are you with me? So the sacrifice is ongoing. Then, listen again, read the preface. In the preface of the priesthood which we use today, and which we use always during the priestly ordinations, the preface is concluded with Father. These ones have chosen are to give their lives in your service and for the salvation of your people. As they strive to grow in the likeness of Christ and honor you by their courageous witness of faith and love. So they try to grow in the likeness of Christ and offer their lives as a sacrifice, as Christ offered. But this sacrifice is in faith and in love. So it is the sacrifice of love. That is the priesthood. It is a gift from God. And you respond to that gracious gift by responding and accepting that gift and sacrificing yourself with Christ for the salvation of the world. But it is not a sacrifice unto nothingness. It is not like a chicken you tie down and throw into the bush for some pagan ritual. And the chicken dies there, and the selflessness, then the blessings of God will be coming down on God's people and on you yourself. Peter asked our Lord, what about us? Who have left everything and followed you? What is our own portion? And Christ said, you who have left everything, father, mother, wife, children, everything to follow me, you will have these things a hundredfold in this present life, and eternal life in the life to come. So the sacrifice is not a miserable sacrifice. It is not a waste. It is the sacrifice that gives glory to God and attracts his blessings in abundance on his people. But you must keep sacrificing. And how do you sacrifice? It is in love, in fidelity, and chastity. Fidelity, unwavering fidelity to the teachings and principles of Christ. Love, unconquerable goodwill towards those entrusted to you. Chastity, embodiment of purity, nobility, integrity, and a life of commitment. If you live your life this way, The sacrifice is ongoing, and the glory of the Lord will manifest in you. You do not need to demonstrate to somebody you are living the life. The glory of the Lord will be shining on you as it was shining on the face of Moses. He did not know his face was glittering, but the Israelites were unable to look at his face, because the glory of the Lord was shining like the sun, like the rays of the sun. The same way, when you live the life of sacrifice of love, love of God and devil, which is the priesthood, the glory of the Lord will manifest in you in that entire life. And the kingdom of God will spread through your ministry. And the kingdom of God will continue to be blessed through your instrumentality. And that is the priesthood of Christ. What are we to do? The next point. For you, the priest, prayer. Without me, you can do nothing. Christ was ready to do that. You cannot live the life of the priesthood without prayer. So you get yourself glued to the master through prayer. And you continue praying to Our Lady, the mother of priests, so that she will continue to intercede for you and obtain the graces of the priesthood. What are we supposed to do as Christians? It is a privilege to support the ministry of Christ. So we have this privilege, which is our duty. And you give the support by praying for your priests, offering good advice, giving them material support according to their needs. Don't steal in order to give other. Don't give what you don't have. Don't take from other persons in order to give. Give from what you have. One thing you can always afford, and that is your prayer. And one thing you must not do, I hear me, ask the person near you, is he here or is he here? Touch the person near you. Good. I said, one thing you must not do. Now listen to me. Do not constitute an obstacle. Do not constitute a roadblock. Do not constitute a problem to the work of Father. And do not be an occasion of sin. Are you hearing me? If you cannot help, do not hinder. If you cannot help, do not do what? Do not hinder. Don't be an occasion of sin. Don't constitute an obstacle. Don't constitute a stumbling block or a problem to the ministry of Christ. But remember that when you help, even through your prayers, the Lord has said, he who gives a prophet a cup of cold water because he is a prophet will receive the prophet's what? Reward. So how many of you want to receive the prophet's reward? If you want to receive the prophet's reward, raise your hand. Then support the ministry of the priest. The Lord be with you.
As Bishop, he will ask the Reverend Deacon then whether for true, them want from each father, and whether them pray for do the work, how a challenge he want. The Deacon then go promise, say, them don't hear and say them for do the thing, where Bishop and Bishop share them for tell them.
My dear sons, before you enter the order of the priesthood, you must declare before the people your intention to undertake this office. Do you resolve, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to discharge without fail the office of priesthood in the presbyteral rank as worthy fellow workers with the order of bishops in caring for the Lord's glory?
I am.
Resolve, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to discharge without fail the office of priesthood in the presbyteral rank as worthy fellow workers with the order of bishops in caring for the Lord's flock.
I do.
Do you resolve to enter the ministry of the word worthy and wisely, preaching the gospel and teaching the Catholic faith?
I do.
Do you resolve to celebrate faithfully and reverently, in accord with the church's tradition, the mysteries of Christ, especially the sacrifice of the Holy Eucharist and the sacrament of reconciliation for the glory of God and the sanctification of the Christian people?
I do.
Do you resolve to implore with us God's mercy upon the people entrusted to their care by observing the command to pray without ceasing?
I do.
And do you resolve to be united more closely every day to Christ the High Priest, who offered himself for us to the Father as a pure sacrifice, and will keep to consecrate yourselves to God for the salvation of all?
I do.
Do you promise to present the obedience to the will of God, Mary?
I do.
May God bless you and be good work in your
and make them thank God for this good brother when the one will be father. When that one is not finished, I, Bishop, and the father will open them hand for a brother in heaven. This one indeed for sure say, Holy Spirit, don't come to give them the power where father will get them. After, Bishop will not pray for the nation. And after this prayer, Reverend Jude Bibini, Reverend Eugene Granton, Reverend Kennedy Apu, Reverend Gunther Leke, Wolfgang Dembobina, Father.
My beloved people, let us pray that God, your mighty and all-powerful Father, will pour out abundantly the gifts of heaven on these servants, whom he has chosen for the office of priest.
Don't know, let us all stand.
Stand.
and pour out of these seven souls the blessing of the Holy Spirit and the power of His grace. That those who deserve of the mercy we offer to be consecrated may be surrounded by the rich and unfailing gifts. This is also to Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Right now, ladies and gentlemen, all the priests present, they are coming for the laying of hands on the newly ordained priest, inviting the Holy Spirit to take possession of them, reserving them at the service of Christ and Christ alone. And after this laying of hands, ladies and gentlemen, the Reverend Constant Leke Golefak will finally become priest. He is the very first with the white vestment, witnessing the laying of hands, ladies and gentlemen, all the religious, all the priests, laying hands, solemnly inviting the Holy Spirit to take possession of the newly ordained. It is only after this, the announcer told us that the Reverend Constant Leke Golefak will become a Reverend Father.
Draw near, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, Author of human dignity. It is you who apportion all graces. Through you everything progresses. Through you all things are made to stand firm. To form a priestly people, you appoint ministers of Christ your Son by the power of the Holy Spirit, arranging them in different orders. Already in the earlier covenant, offices arose established through mystical rites. When you sent Moses and Aaron over your people to govern them and sanctify them, you chose men next in rank and dignity to accompany them and assist them in their task. So too, in the desert, you implanted the spirit of Moses in the hearts of 70 wise men, and with your help, he ruled your people with greater ease. So also upon the sons of Aaron, you bore an abundant share of their father's plenty, that the number of the priests prescribed by the law might be sufficient for the sacrifices of the tabernacle, which were a shadow of the good things to come. Send your own Son into the world, Jesus, who is apostle and high priest of our confession. Through the Holy Spirit, he offered himself to you as a spotless victim, and he made his apostles consecrated in the truth, sharers in his mission. You provided them also with companions to proclaim and carry out the work of salvation throughout the whole world. And now we beseech you, Lord, in our weakness, to grant us these helpers that we need, to exercise the priesthood that comes from the apostles. Grant, we pray you, Almighty Father, to these the servants, the dignity of the holy priesthood. Renew deep within them the spirit of holiness. May they henceforth possess this office which comes from you, O Lord our God, and is next in rank to the office of bishop. And by the example of their manner of life, may they instill right conduct. May they be worthy co-workers with our order, the order of nations, so that by their preaching and through the grace of the Holy Spirit, the words of the gospel may bear fruit in human hearts and reach to the ends of the earth. Together with us, Holy Father, may they be faithful stewards of your mysteries, so that your people may be renewed in the waters of the earth, nourished from your altar, so that sinners may be reconciled and receive grace up. May they be joined with us, Lord, in the glory of your mercy for the people entrusted to their care and for all the world. And so may the full number of the nations gathered together in Christ be transformed into your one people and made perfect in your kingdom. We ask this people through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Just now, Reverend Judy Bibiu, Reverend Judy Ramjo, Reverend Kennedy Apua, Reverend Constance Leke, Bolivar, then don't be now, Father. Wow.
receive the oblation of the Holy Spirit of God to be offered to God our Almighty Father. Understand what you do, imitate what you celebrate, and conform your life to the mystery of the Lord's cross.
Thank you.